Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. It's time for the monthly Q&A. We are in the middle of summer. If you are living in a very warm region, please pay attention not to oversweat when you are training. Like I mentioned before, in the summertime, you should not sweat too much in each training session. Personally, I take a more relaxed and natural approach to training on a very warm day. Let's take a quick look at the questions for today. First, PJ, my anger issue. Second, Alex Navarro, importance of lineage. Third, Ernesto Pong, qi versus qi. Fourth, from Fred Talks, type of qigong. Fifth, and sixth from Kelly Wang, qigong and internal power, single movements. Seventh, from SI, star walking. Number eight, from SI2, real dantian. Number nine, blade zinc 50, huang and neigong. Tenth, from Farhan, hips and waist. 11th, from Tai Chi Chuan, Chen Tai Chi and power release. 12th, from Frederick Gordon, correct places for palm and fist strikes. 13th, from Dominic Lee, Xing Yi and MMA. 14th, from Antonius Samir, Suo Gu Gong. By the way, I have received some very good questions for this video. I wanted to answer all of them in this very video. However, some questions, like the ones asked by Alfred JRL and Leland, need dedicated videos. So, Alfred JRL and Leland, I will answer your questions in future videos. So, without any further ado, let's get started. The first question from PJ asks a very short but interesting question. Why are you so angry? Well, PJ, I cannot help it. I was born angry. I'm kidding, okay? I wasn't born angry. My wife makes me angry, but I'm helpless in front of her. So, I vent all my anger in front of the camera. The camera is the only one in this house that cares about me. I'm just kidding again. Jokes apart, what you see and hear from me is not anger, but rather a result of the typical way of speaking Mandarin in Tianjin, China, my hometown. Also, I was mostly self-taught in English. So, it's not surprising that my approach to Mandarin cascades into my approach to English. By the way, I recommend you watch my video titled Decoding Martial Proverbs Number 1, 4 ounces, 1000 pound, Dantian Energy, in which I explain the concept of Qi Chen Dantian, which is the basis of my approach to speaking Mandarin. That should give you some more context on my way of speaking. Link is in the description. PJ hopes that answers your question. Now, let's move on to the next question. Question number two from Alex Navarro asks, Q&A, to what extent do you think lineage matter? I'm asking because a lot of traditional schools say they are better, more legitimate than other schools, drawing on some argument based on lineage purity. A critical analysis of these arguments shows they are a little flooded and permitted by cultural utopianism. Do you have any suggestions to help us distinguish what is useful in these discussions from what is just boasting marketing? Thank you, Alex. You are asking some really good questions. Before I begin, let me make something clear. Regarding lineage, I can only speak for myself. Others may have different opinions, and that's totally fine. First of all, Lineage is very important since it indicates the source of your knowledge. Without clear lineage, verification of the standard of practice in any traditional style is very difficult, if not impossible. However, a self-proclaimed lineage or a purchased lineage alone will not provide too much value since it does not reflect the real value of a lineage. In China, lineage selling is a huge business in the martial art community and many teachers participate in it. Many people from the West travel to China and practice with the teacher for a very short period of time and later return with a certificate claiming the teacher's lineage. I call this phenomenon lineage tourism. Unfortunately, this depends on supply and demand, and in such cases, money talks. Personally, if my students' practice can be identical to my own, that is sufficient proof of lineage already. Lineage should be proven in practice, not merely on paper. Naturally, true lineage is earned, not bought. Zhou Zhen posted a related comments to Alex's original question. He asks, related to this, do you have a thought about the necessity of bai shi? Some teachers hold back knowledge for only their disciples, but many contemporary teachers seem to share their knowledge very openly to all. Chen Zhaokui did not take any disciples. Is bai shi a relic of the past or worth preserving? Well, Zhou Zhen, in my opinion, it depends. By the way, bai shi is the procedure of becoming a disciple of a lineage according to the traditional way. Let me say it again. Bai shi is the procedure of becoming a disciple of a lineage. If you respect tradition, then bai shi is the necessary step. However, if you prefer the modern way, then bai shi is not necessary at all. It totally depends on your personal choice as well as your teachers. To your statement about Chen Zhaokui not taking any disciples, well, do not forget that he taught students during the Cultural Revolution, and it would have been really unwise to openly accept disciples. However, many of his long-term students, such as Ma Hong, who was one of my Chen Taiji teachers, as well as Zhang Zhijun, are considered his disciples, since they followed him for a very long period and could effectively represent his teaching. So, in the Taiji community in China, Chen Zhaokui is believed to have had disciples. Speaking of contemporary teachers, well, it may seem that many of them openly share their knowledge. I would caution you against believing this. Teachers can always claim to not keep anything hidden from the general public, but how can you know for certain? Based on my experience, very few teachers openly share all information and practice with others. Again, this is just my opinion. I hope it answers your question. Now, let's look at the next question. Ernesto Pong asked a question about Xiu Dao. Dear Yang Lao Shi, for the next Q&A, I'd like to ask what is the difference between these two qi and qi? Thank you, Ernesto. These two characters have the same pronunciation, and very often many people think they are interchangeable. In reality, they are two characters that have different meanings. These two characters could be considered homophones. Same pronunciation, different meanings. The first character, qi, has been used in Xiu Dao for thousands of years. It is a specific character used in old Xiudao documents. This character consists of two parts. The upper part means Wu or emptiness, while the lower part is Huo or fire. Put together, this character indicates the process of Xiudao practice. Use the fire to burn the emptiness. Fire symbolizes mind in Taoism, and emptiness symbolizes any place wherever energy stores itself. So, this character was created and used in Xiudao practice. For the second qi, yes, the pronunciation is exactly the same as the first qi, but the second qi was first used in history outside of the Taoism and nowadays means qi or energy in common usage. In Chinese medicine, qigong, and many other fields, people only used the second qi character. Especially after 1950s, most of the publishing industry in China used the second character for printing Xiudao books in the modern format. As a result, the original meaning of the first character has been disappearing with time. I hope this explanation is clear now. Let's look at the next question. Frédéric Leclerc, aka Fred Talk, a former Tai Chi student of mine, asked the question about the Qigong and the martial practice. Regarding that inner power is not achieved by Qigong in general, could you please develop more the in general part? Also, how do hard Qigong, such as Iron Palm, Iron Vest, fit in relation to this statement? Frederick, thank you for your question. First of all, there are five categories of Qigong based on differences in their practical principles and historical background, defined about 30 years ago. These categories include Taoist Qigong, Buddhist Qigong, Confucian Qigong, Medical Qigong, and Martial Qigong. So, I used the term in general to express that there are five categories of Qigong. In martial art practice, internal power is developed using the right body mechanism included in the martial art practice itself, instead of any separate Qigong practice. As for hard Qigong, aka martial Qigong, only involves hard physical training. It has nothing to do with internal power at all. In other words, you do not need any separate Qigong practice to develop internal power. Frederick, hope that answers the question. Let's move on to the next question. Question number 5. Kelly Wang says, I'm glad someone else finally said it, but I have been telling people for years that you cannot develop internal power with Qigong alone. And actually, like you mentioned in the video, it is supplemental and not required to stand training and single movement exercise. With that being said, I have two questions which perhaps you may include in the next Q&A video. First, how does Qigong help with developing internal power? Second, how do you define single movement exercise? Does it have to be done stationary like you did in the demonstration, or are forms like Xing Yi Five Elements, Bagua single palm, double palm, etc. considered single movements? As always, appreciate your sharing your insight and knowledge. P.S. I have my own opinion on number one, but would like to hear your take on it first. Kelly, thank you for your questions. To your first question about Qigong and internal power, my answer is and will always be the same. Qigong only provides indirect benefit in martial art practice. It can help you build a better energy sensitivity, and you may be better able to sense the internal connections between different aspects such as posture, energy, and energy flow of a movement. Qigong is no substitute for martial movements toward your goal of developing internal power. To your second question about single movement exercise, any movement that is simple and provides a limited but well-defined function to build strength, improve speed, and specific benefits can be considered a single movement. Five elements and a single palm are not single movements, they are forms. You can break them down into different single movement exercises, but they are not single exercises themselves. Hope that answers your question, Kelly. Like, looks like the next question. And question number 7. I ask two interesting questions. First, do you know anything about star walking? 不刚踏斗? It's rare from what little I know, but it's still practiced in some overseas Chinese communities, like in Malaysia, I think Taiwan as well. Second, I heard that the cordon of the body needs to be created and is the real Dan Tian. Is this true? Thank you, SI. Yes, of course, I know about star walking. It is not a rare subject at all. Bu Gang Ta Dou is a religious Taoist practice used in religious ceremonies. The idea is to call upon sages and the god in Taoism. It has been practiced for thousands of years and has been documented in many important Taoist documents. For example, this one, titled Yun Ji Qi Qian. Okay? Even today, there are many Taoist temples in China that still perform such rituals. Of course, some people may claim that such rituals can provide other abilities, such as the ability to communicate with the spirit of a dead person. Whether you believe it or not is up to you. By the way, star walking is not a martial art practice. It's quite possible many people appreciate the movements of that religious ritual and try to practice it in martial art training. End of the day, it is simply a conflation of religious Taoism with martial art practice. Just like how people may add Coca-Cola to a nice glass of French wine, since they have similar color. So, if someone tells you their Bagua Zhang practice is from Bu Gang Ta Dou, be assured they are either being dishonest or they learned from dishonest teachers, neither of which is worth your time and attention. As for your second question, that is simply their claim, not a fact. In fact, I do not believe it at all. I have a video introducing many different Dan Tian concepts. The title of that video is Dan Tian, the source of internal strength is planned. Please watch that video and I'm sure you will find the answer for your question. Link is in the description. Hope that answers your questions. And let's look at the next question. Question number 9. Blazing Ink 50 asks, a guy I'm learning from talks about expanding the Huang inside the body. Did you learn this when you were learning Nei Gong? At the first place, I did not understand his question. Then I asked him back in order to clarify the word Huang in his comment. Then he wrote back as, I think what he was saying is your stake your bone relaxed and hang your muscles and the connective tissues that you start to expand IOS the Huang. Thank you, Blazing 50. I think I understand your question now. Let me first introduce the history of this concept, after which I will answer your question. To the best of my knowledge, Wang Xiangzhai, one of the most prominent masters of the 20th century and the founder of Yiquan or Da Chengquan, was the first person who used the term 玉树挂宝衣 to describe the result of a practice. Literally translated, 玉 means jade, 树 means tree, 挂 means hand, 宝 means treasure, 衣 means cloth. Put together, this term means that upon reaching a very high level in practice, your body seems to have a treasured cloth hanging on the tree. So, what exactly are the tree and the cloth in this context? According to Wang Xiangzhai's writing and his student's explanation, 玉树 or jade tree is the bone structure or skeleton, while 宝衣 or treasured cloth constitutes the muscle and tendons. So, this term expresses that in an advanced level of internal practice, our bone and our muscle would not be in the ordinary state. The bone structure and the muscle structure will play a different role in practice. It is an advanced topic, and for now, I'm just sharing that information with you at a simplified level. Of course, there are other explanations of this term, such as the jade tree symbolizes the mind, and the treasured cloth symbolizes the body. But most people prefer the first explanation. I did say that that proverb was first written by Wang Xiangzhai, the founder of Yichuan. But in his writing, he credited another great martial art master by the name Xie Tiefu with teaching it to him, Wang Xiangzhai. He said he studied with Xie Tiefu for about a year when he traveled around China in order to improve his martial practice. However, there's no official record of Xie Tiefu anywhere in the Chinese martial art community. This is why some people believe that Wang Xiangzhai himself created this proverb but gave credit to Xie Tiefu, a non-existent name, in order to show the legitimacy of his creation. In Chinese culture, it is hard for the public to accept the fact that someone invented a theory without a source of information. This is an unfortunate result of cultural utopianism, which is still prevalent in China. I have talked about this phenomenon in many of my previous videos. I asked Wang Yufang, the daughter of Wang Xiangzhai, about this story. She confirmed that Xie Tiefu taught Wang Xiangzhai this proverb. My suggestion is that you should not dwell upon the creator of this proverb and instead focus on the proverb itself. It is a profound, deep, and advanced proverb. So, that is the historical content of the term. Now, let's come back to Blazing 50's question. I do not think that there is such a term, Huang, in this case, but based on what you have described, I believe it is the expression of the Yu Shu Gua Bao Yi, not Huang. I hope I have answered your question. Now, let's move on to the next question. Question number 10 from Furhan asks an interesting technique-related question. What is the relationship between the hips and the waist, or yao? The practice I study, such as shui jiao, emphasize using the waist for generating power and being the origin of movements. How can I apply your words on routine to my practice? Thank you, Farhan. Now, it is the big topic and I can only provide a brief answer here. First of all, there is a popular term in the Xingyi community that I created over 10 years ago, Yao Kua Bu Fen, which describes the incorrect practice of waist and hip, or the situation where one cannot differentiate between the waist and the hip. The confusion between waist and hip in practice is the common mistake which is the translation of 腰胯不分. Basically, the waist is used for turning movements, while hips are used for creating a solid structure. Both of them typically work simultaneously. In Fa Jin, typically the hips should maintain the structure, while the waist creates the turning so that the force of the Dantian area can transfer to the arms. This is the most important principle of the application of waist and hips in Fa Jin. Rooting force should begin in the Dantian area and then transmit through the hips to the feet. That is the key principle of rooting practice. I hope this answers your question, Farhan. I'm aware it is a short answer, but it should touch on all the key points. Let's look at the next question. Question 11, Tai Chi Chuan. A friend of mine who moved from Ontario, Canada to Shanghai, China, who studied Chen Zhaokui lineage Tai Chi, asks, "Hello, Ms. Yang, if I may, I will ask a question. Context, Chen Tai Chi Chuan. Nature of a question. Using power in practice. Explanation. I have seen various practitioners express power, speed times force, while practicing Chen Tai Chi, but usually only during specific movements. Furthermore, they only express it at a specific point within movement. I can think of the ending of the Buddha Pound Mortar, for example, when the fist strikes the palm as one such movement. However, not too many practitioners are expressing power during transitional movements. For example, there are many movements which I have never seen done powerfully at all. In your opinion, are there any instances within a Chen Tai Chi form where power should not be used? If there is the practitioner who chooses to use power at any moment, whenever they feel like it, at any point in any movement, are they failing in some fundamental understanding of Chen Tai Chi? Or instead, is Chen Tai Chi Chuan a canvas where power can be expressed in any movement, not the discretion of a skilled practitioner? And if yes, why do you suppose there are dogmatic power expression even among higher skilled practitioners who could vary their forms, but don't, and continue to show power expression in a very same movements all the time? Or is there a different way of thinking about all of this?" Okay, thank you for your question, Tai Chi Chuan. Well, most movements in the Tai Chi routine, if not all, have self-defense applications. And any self-defense practice needs movements to be executed at a sufficient speed and with sufficient force. So, Fa Jin can be applied for all such movements in the routine. For your second question regarding movements where power should not be used, I would say that only a few movements meant primarily for relaxation purposes, like the ending posture after single whip, can avoid using power. We call this kind of posture 过渡式, or transitional posture. These movements are at the end of each small form and are used to connect and prepare for the next movement. So overall, power can be released during any or all movements in the routine as per the practitioner's choice. Let me remind you all, slow movements are only for practice, never for application. If you want to use Tai Chi for self-defense, you have to practice fast and powerful movements, which is Fa Jin. Tai Chi Chuan, I hope that answers your question. Take good care in Shanghai. Now, let's look at the next question. Question number 12, from Frederic Gaudin. A former student of mine in Montreal asked me a question about the soft, hard part of our body regarding a striking strategy. He asks, you mentioned in a previous video that it is relevant to think of palms for use on harder parts of the body, whereas fists are convenient for softer parts. Would it be possible to detail which part of the body are considered hard or soft? For instance, is the head entirely hard or only some part of it? Similarly, is the entire midsection considered soft? Hello, Fred. Thank you for your question. Yes, in addition to the prior video, I also remember very well that I talked about this topic in our Xinyi class about 10 years ago too. My answer to you is that overall, in Chinese martial art practice, in terms of martial attacking, most of the theories are based on our upper body or torso. Of course, there are different regions such as limbs and head, but they can be considered as the extension of the torso. Comparatively, the chest is considered a hard part and the stomach area is considered a soft part. To those who haven't watched my previous video yet, what I'm talking about is the general martial strategy in which you normally use your fist to attack a soft area such as the stomach and use your palm to attack the opponent's chest area. But this is only a general guideline, nothing set in stone, since alternatively, the fist can also be used to strike the chest and the open palm can also be used to strike the stomach. I'm talking more about efficiency, not the effectiveness alone. Fred, I hope this answer is clear. Now, let's look at the next question. Question number 13 from Dominic Lee asks a question about Xingyi application with MMA. He says, if you had to bring the application of Xingyi into modern MMA competition, which aspect techniques do you think would be practical? And which part do you think should be discarded? Also, why is the practice of Taolu so disconnected from sparring and or actual combat application? Thank you, Dominique. This is a great question. First off, I have to say that I'm not familiar with MMA at all. In order to keep my own practice as pure as possible, I intentionally refuse to watch martial art videos of other styles. I especially avoid watching non-Chinese style of practice. Let me be clear, I'm not looking down upon them. Rather, I don't want my practice to get influenced by other styles. As a martial artist, my mind is very sharp with respect to grasping different practice from different styles. Of course, it is a great idea to borrow different practice from different systems. But as a martial art teacher, especially someone carrying the lineage of a few styles, I have to be very careful in dealing with practice from other styles. If I was not in a position to transmit practice to future generations in an authentic way, I would have loved to study different styles such as Western boxing and other martial art systems. But sometimes you need to make sacrifice in your pursuit of the great goal. To answer your question, I have to say that the fighting and the practice related content of Xingyi is vast and well-developed. Xingyi has been considered the most practical martial art system in Chinese martial art community for over a century due to its unique training approach. However, in order to compete with others in MMA competition, training method, especially the intensity of physical practice, the cardio exercise, the sparring practice, among others, have to be added into your daily routine. Or else, a good system may not be able to play its desired role in a competition. For any competition, specific training is necessary, or else it would simply remain a dream or illusion. As for the routine practice, a good practitioner should be able to apply movements from the style with little to no modification and adaptation in combat. This is the practitioner's problem, not the practice itself. Dominique, I hope my answer is helpful. Now, let's look at the final question for today. Topic number 14. Antonius Sami asks a very interesting question. What is Suo Gu Gong and what you know about it? I think Suo Gu Gong would be a very new topic to most of you, so I'd like to introduce it briefly today. Suo Gu Gong is a practice that exists in the martial art community. The term Suo Gu Gong consists of three characters. Suo means shrink, Gu means bone, Gong means practice. Together, it means practice that can shrink the bones. In the old times, some people practiced this in order to be able to pass through a small space by changing their body structure or skeletal structure. This was often practiced by thieves so that they could enter a room through a small window. Street performers would also demonstrate Suo Gu Gong related to feats. In contrast, I have to say that it was not and still isn't a popular practice in the martial art community at all, since it was only used toward non-martial art related goals, some of which I mentioned just now. Suo Gu Gong is a very tough practice. You have to change the bone structure, loosen the joint with the intention to dislocating them at will. Think about it. Dislocation of a joint is a very painful experience to begin with. Now imagine the experience of intentionally dislocating joints on a regular basis. Such joint dislocation is a very unhealthy practice. It is good to be aware of this practice, but not necessary to experience it by yourself. I certainly would never recommend this to anyone who asks for my advice. By the way, if any of you are thinking of Suo Gu Gong as an easy way of making money, let me tell you the easiest way to make money. You can instead create and sell your own lineage under the name of legendary figures like Zhang Sanfeng or UFA. In fact, I'm thinking of creating my own cult called Wu Dang Apple Pie, with Steve Jobs as the founder. I will never allow Windows and the Linux user to join my cult anyway. So, that brings us to the end of today's video. I have answered many questions today. Like I mentioned in the beginning of the video, I will answer the rest of the questions in the future, possibly in a different format. Thank you for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice.